Okay, let's all stand up tonight, if you would, please. And if you want to use your hymn book, you can. 391, or look at the screen. I'd rather have Jesus than anything. Let's sing this tonight, page 391.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
We're singing some different songs on Wednesday night, so you may not know some of these, but we're going to learn them anyway. And since I'm leading tonight, I get to pick out the songs, so that's the way it goes. So turn to page number 497. It's a great song, Brighten the Corner Where You Are. Let me get to the page here. I'm not quite there yet. Thank you for playing on. Okay. All right, give me a little more introduction. I'll be ready to go.
Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed his light afar. To the many duties ever near you, now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Just above our clouded skies that you may help to clear. Let not narrow self your way be bar. Though into one heart alone may fall your song of cheer. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Here for all your talent you may surely find a need.
here reflect the bright and morning star. Even from your humble hand, the bread of life may feed. Brighten the corner where you are. 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 Let's sing that first verse one more time. Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. To the many duties ever near you now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Hide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Let's shake hands tonight as she plays through a song verse. Like you're about happy that you're in church tonight. That's a good thing. All right, let's turn to sing at Calvary tonight. Page number 57, Years I Spent in Vanity and Pride, Caring Not My Lord Was Crucified. Page number 57 at Calvary.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me, he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great, grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've gifted Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.
Before we sing the last verse, how many are glad you're saved tonight? Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Isn't that a great verse there? Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Let's sing it now.
Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary.
Sing it out now. Mercy.
mercy there was great, and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary.
Good singing tonight. Thank you so much. You may be seated tonight. I'm a fill-in, so when I get a fill-in, we get a workout in the singing department. All right. Used to do that a few years ago. So, all right. Let's take our Bibles tonight, and I'll go from this microphone to another microphone. For coming to church tonight. It's a lot warmer in here than it is outside, isn't it? Oh, the younger I get, the more I understand why people go to Florida when they get older. Some of you got that, didn't you? Okay. I do understand. We have some of our men out in the west where it's warm and some in the south where it's warm tonight. But we're glad that you're here. Take your Bible and turn to Daniel tonight, chapter 1, verse 8. Dealing on Wednesday nights, we're dealing with commitments that will change your life. Of course, the month of February on Sunday morning, Sunday night, preaching on the heart and the importance of the heart. Hope you're enjoying that series of messages. It's been a help and encouragement to me. I think it has been to a lot of people. But tonight, we're in kind of a series on Wednesday night about commitments that will change your life. So Daniel chapter 1 and verse number 8, the Bible says, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself." Now the phrase purpose there, Daniel purposed in his heart, that means to be committed. It means to be committed to a course of action. And so tonight we're going to continue on the series of messages. We preached the first message in this series last Wednesday night. This is the second message in this series on Wednesday night. And these are things that we need to be committed to. Committed to a course of action. Daniel purposed in his heart. That's why when the king said that you can't pray, he'd already purposed in his heart. And he was praying three times a day. And the Bible says as soon as the decree was signed, that Daniel went to Enormo's place and he opened up the windows and he prayed three times a day because he was purposed in his heart. He had already committed these things in his life, to committed to serve God with his life, especially in the area of prayer. So we're going to look at some things tonight, very practical, go over quickly last week's message, very quickly, just the points, and then we're going to get started tonight. Thank you again for coming tonight. Hope the message is a help to you, and I'm glad you showed up tonight. I'm glad you're here. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the privilege of being in church tonight, and thank you for our people who are here. Lord, I pray that you'll speak to our hearts as only you can, and Lord, we definitely need commitment. In the day in which we live, there's such a lack of commitment everywhere. But Lord, even sometimes in the lives of Christians, there's not much commitment. And so Lord, help us to be committed to some things. And this series of messages on things that we need to be committed to, help us as a Christian to learn and then be purposeful in our life and to be committed to a course of action and follow that course of action wherever it leads us according to God's Word. So Lord, thank you for our time tonight. And help us to learn some things from commitments that will change our lives tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Daniel purposed in his heart. This means to be committed to a course of action. So let's look into the scripture and see some commitments that will change your life. Now, none of these things will change your life if you only hear them. I've preached on that before, that you got to hear the word and then you got to take the word of God, hear it as truth. And we talked about in the month of January stewardship, and the whole month of January is on stewardship in all services. And we had one of the messages was on the stewardship of truth. So I give you the truth of God's word in every service. So we hear the truth, we must commit to the truth, and then we must practice the truth. So once we hear the truth, we must believe it as truth. We must believe that is truth, and then we must say, I'm going to put that into practice in my life and be committed to the course of action of truth. So none of these commitments will help you, and they'll never change your life unless you're committed to them. They're good things from God's Word. They're practical things. They're things that everyone can learn from. And it's easy listening and learning tonight from God's Word. And so these are a series of messages that will help us to make commitments. And last Wednesday night, we started this series. And the first thing we talked about was be committed in your service to the Lord. Now, we're not going to re-preach the message, but we gave several scriptures about that last week. We talked about be committed to follow the will of God for your life. And we looked at several scriptures on that particular point. And then we talked about being committed to God and give God your best effort. And one of my favorite verses I learned in camp years ago, 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether therefore you eat or you drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. As a Christian, you ought to give it your best. You ought to give it the very best you can. You ought to give God your best in everything. Even in singing in the song service on a cold Wednesday night, give it your best. I'm trying to give it my best. And so give it your best. In everything, be committed to give God your very best. How many believe that God deserves our best? Amen? He deserves our best. So we ought to be committed to that and do the very best we can in every area of our Christian life. And then we talked about being committed to remembering what the Lord has done for you. And boy, we talked about that last week, and boy, that's a great point in Scripture. And remembering what God has done for you in your life, the Bible talks much about remembrance and those type of things. And then we talked about be committed to refrain from sinful choices. Be committed to commit from refraining from sinful choices. And so that was the message last week, and here's the message for tonight. Be committed to trusting the Lord. Be committed to trusting the Lord. Let's take our Bibles and go to Proverbs. It's one of my favorite verses. A lot of times when I write letters or cards, I will always sign this passage of Scripture, one of my favorite verses. Every Christian really ought to have a life verse that you commit to memory that's important to you. Maybe you have many verses, but this is kind of one of those verses, kind of a life verse. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy path. And when it talks about acknowledging Him, it means to recognize the Lord in all our ways. In every area of our life, recognize the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and make sure you recognize Him in all aspects of your life. The word trust simply means this, to have a bold confidence in the Lord. Now, how many have a bold confidence in the Lord? Have a bold confidence in the Lord to the point of being carefree because you know God is in control and He's caring for you. Now, I'm preparing a message, not for this Sunday, but I'm started a message today on the providential care of God in our life and how God cares for us and God how God guides us and watches over us. And it's going to be a wonderful message as we look into the Word of God about the providential care of God in our life. And God does want to help us. We develop different types of trust. There's different kinds of trust that we're going to look at here in the Bible in just a moment. But take your Bible and go back to the book of Job. Go back to the book of Job. And Job's a great book in the Bible. A few years ago, I preached through the book of Job. And you don't hardly ever hear many people preaching through the book of Job. You'll hear different messages, but that was a wonderful series of messages, and I really enjoyed the study of the book of Job past just some of the certain types of messages that we're familiar with in the book of Job. But it's a great book, has a lot of great material in the book of Job. But in Job chapter 13 and verse 15, the Bible says, Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him, but I will maintain mine own ways before him. Job had great confidence in the Lord. And even though he was going through great difficulty in his life, and he didn't know why all the things were happening to him in his life, he really felt like if he could come face to face and talk to God, that he could talk to God and say, God, this really isn't fair. This isn't really right. But he had great trust in God. And he said, even though he does all these things to me, I'm going to trust the Lord. So be committed. Be committed to trusting the Lord. Now that's a great point tonight. And it's a great truth tonight. Because we're living in a world that's not trusting in a whole lot of anything right now. And Christians have sometimes lost their trust and things like that. But be committed to trusting the Lord. And I was just talking yesterday, I was visiting with my mother, and we were talking about just things in our life and what God's done. You ever just sit around and think and talk about what God's done in your life? And we went back and how my mom got saved, my dad got saved, and then we got in church and how we started out in life, and then we got saved and how God just changed our life and made everything. Every one of us ought to take time to go back and just thank the Lord that He saved you, if you're saved, and that you can trust the Lord. And even we were talking way back in the days we didn't have much, still trust the Lord. And then the Lord would take care of us, and then bring us a little bit farther, and give us a little bit more, and trust the Lord, give a little more. And today, God has blessed us in remarkable ways. Why? Because we've trusted the Lord, even in the difficult times and the hard times. And always be committed to trusting the Lord. He'll not ever let you down. But there's different types of trust when we think about trusting the Lord. So let's look at some of those tonight in Scripture. Genesis, go to Genesis chapter 7 tonight. Genesis chapter 7. Always get excited about teaching the Bible and preaching the Bible. And I hope you enjoy listening to the teaching of the Bible and hope it's a help to you in your life. But it's great to know that in trusting the Lord that we can be committed to trusting the Lord. And there's different types of trust. And in Genesis chapter 7, verse number 1, down through verse number 5, we see obedient trust. And this is in the life of a man by the name of Noah. And the Lord said unto Noah, verse 1, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens, the male and his female, and of beasts that are not clean by two, the male and his female. Of fowls also of the air by sevens, the male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of all the earth, for yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain. Now let's not just run by that phrase. It had never rained on the earth up to this point. And God said it's going to rain. I'm thinking in my mind, I wonder what Noah was thinking when God said it's going to rain. Because the Bible says that in those days, the ground was watered from the dew from the ground up until the flood. And so, yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights, and every living substance that I have made will I destroy from off the face of the earth. And Noah did according unto all that the Lord commanded him. He told him it was going to rain. He told him to get the animals in the ark. He told him to build the ark. He told him the specifications of the ark. He told him how to build the ark. Everything that he had to do. And Noah was obedient that he trusted God. Now tonight, has God ever told you to do something? Has He ever told you to do something? Has anybody, nobody said, has He ever told you to do something? Sure He has. Have you been obedient to do what He's asked you to do? When you think about Noah, he didn't know what rain was. You're building an ark for a flood. Well, what's a flood? I mean, really, that had never happened. But yet he believed God. He was committed to trusting God. And he was committed to obediently trusting God in every aspect and every specification. As you study the building of the ark, what type of wood, how to build it, how large to make it, everything, the doors, the window, everything about it. He followed it implicitly, and he had great trust in God, and he had obedient trust. Be committed to trusting the Lord. And then we see in Genesis chapter 24, turn to Genesis chapter 24 and verse number 1, we see a confident trust. And this is Abraham, and the Bible says, and Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said unto his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. That's a great statement. Don't get involved with heathen women. Don't marry what we would say unsaved women today. And yet, how many times do Christian people marry unsaved people? It brings all kinds of heartache into their life. Verse number 4. But thou shalt go unto my country and to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said unto him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land from whence thou camest? And Abraham said unto him, beware thou that thou bring not thy son thither again. The Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me, and that sware unto me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land, he shall send his angel before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. Abraham was confident the Lord would provide a wife for his son Isaac. And he was confident that he would provide the right son. Now turn to Genesis chapter 30. We see another illustration of confident trust on the part of Rachel in Genesis chapter 30, verse number 22. The Bible says, and God remembered Rachel and hearkened unto her and opened her womb. There's several women in the scripture. I preached this a long time ago. But there's several women in the scripture that could not have children, that the Bible says then, whose womb the Lord opened. With man, things are impossible. With God, nothing is impossible with God, is it? And so, and God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened to her, and opened her womb, and she conceived, and she bare a son, and said, God hath taken away my reproach, and she called his name Joseph, and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. And so Rachel had confident trust that the Lord would give her another son. Go to 1 Kings chapter 17, 1 Kings chapter 17, and let's look at another person who had confident trust. And this was the prophet Elijah. In Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse number 12, verse number 12 of 1 Kings chapter 17, and verse number 12. And the Bible says in 1 Kings 17, 12, And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal. And this is the widow that Elijah goes to see. And she's desperate. She's destitute. She just has a little bit of food left for her and her son. Going to make a cake, going to eat it, they're going to die. I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks, that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said to her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first. I always thought that was selfish. When I read that, I thought, Elijah, why? This lady has nothing, and yet you want to have a first cake, you know. But there's a reason for that. And bring it unto me, and after make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days, and the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail according to the word of the Lord which he spake by Elijah. Confident trust that God would take care of her needs. You really believe that tonight, church? Do you believe that God can take care of your needs? Sure He can. And look back at your life. If you've been committed to Him, you'll see time and time and time again where He met your need. As I was talking to my mom the other day, we were just thinking way back and way back and way back, and what God did, and God saved the family. Each one of us got saved, and how God gave us stuff along the way. And look what God did here, and look what God did. And I told my mom, I said, you need to write a book, Mom. You need to put all this in a book so that we know someday when you're no longer here upon this earth that we have a history of what took place in our family. And that would be a blessing. And I'm saying that tonight in front of the church, Mom. You need to do that, okay? I'm not saying that's God's will for your life, but I'm saying that'd be a good thing for you to do tonight. But isn't it wonderful to look back? And if we all take time to look back, I got my journal out today, and I was looking at my journal. I tell you about journaling. I think every Christian ought to journal. And on good days and bad days, and put down whatever's going on that day. Maybe it's a good day, maybe it's a bad day. But it'll help you in times when you're struggling to get look back in your journal and see what God did, because you'll forget. And I look back today, and I thought, wow. And you know what one of those days said? On this day, I think it was July 7th, I led my father-in-law to Christ at Rosegate Nursing Home. And I put that in my journal. And you know, I've been praying for my father-in-law for a long time and asked God to give me a window. You know the story? He gave me a 2-inch window. A locked window and this little screen, and I led my father-in-law to Christ. And in my journal, I recorded on that day in July 2020, he got saved. That's wonderful. You can trust God. You say, I got people in my family. I say, keep praying for them. Keep praying and witness to them. And witness to them. Not only did he have confident faith, not only did Noah have obedient faith, but another faith is found in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles. That's a book we don't go to often, but 2 Chronicles is a good book. A lot of good material in there. And there is courageous trust in 2 Chronicles chapter 32 and verse number 7 and 8. And this is King Hezekiah. The Assyrian nation is coming down to destroy him. The people are scared to death. The Assyrians were wicked people. Man, they would flay people alive. They would put them on pencil posts coming into the cities and impale the bodies on the post. So any people coming in would see how atrocious they were. They were some of the first terrorists that were ever there. The Assyrians were wicked, 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 wicked people. That's why Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. He hated the Assyrians because they were merciless. They were mean people. They were cruel people. They were vicious people, vindictive people. They buried people in the sand and let the sun and the ants eat the people alive. These were wicked people. You can understand why you say, well, Jonah should... Well, no, but if you lived in that day and you'd heard about the Assyrians, you probably wouldn't have liked them either. I'm not saying his actions were right, but he hated them because they were despicable people. They needed the gospel. They needed to be saved, but they were cruel people. And so you see here, they're coming down and they're invading Judah, and it looks like they're going to get them, and the people are fearful. And Hezekiah, in verse number 7, he has a courageous trust in God. And he says, be strong and courageous, be not afraid nor dismayed for the king of Assyria, nor for all the multitudes that is with him. It's one thing to say words, but when you look out there and you see them as the sands of the sea, and there's thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands, and you know who they are, and you know who the king is, and you know what they've done to the other nations, you're going to be a little bit scared. But Hezekiah is the king, and he said, don't be afraid of them, or even the multitude that's with him, for there be more with us than with him. Really, Hezekiah? With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. And they weren't beaten by the Assyrians because God intervened. And little is much, like the song says, when God is in it. And the Bible says this, you know, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. In my flesh, I'm not that strong. In your flesh, you're not that strong. But in the arm of the Lord, we have all the faith that we need, and we have all the courage that we need to have, no matter what's going on around us. Be committed to trusting the Lord. Are you committed tonight to trusting the Lord? Are you committed to trusting the Lord tonight in having obedient faith? And when God asks you to do something, do you just obey it and do it? Do you have confident trust that God will take care of you? Do you have courageous trust that no matter what's going on around you, that God's in control? Be committed to trusting the Lord. I've been young, the Scripture says, and now I'm old. and I'm not seeing the righteous, what's the next word? Forsaken, or his seed begging bread. What's that mean? He'll meet your needs. He'll give you what you need. If you have confident trust and you're doing what God wants you to do in the Christian life. Now, if you're all over the place, that's another story. But when you're where God wants you to be, you can have confident trust and you can have great trust that God will meet your need. And in my life, over and over and over and over and over again, I've looked back as a pastor, as a person, as a dad, husband, how God has over and over and over, I've trusted God and God has always come through. He always has. Be committed to trusting the Lord. I hope you will. Second thing tonight, be committed to being reliable or faithful. Boy, that's a tough word that's going on in the Christian circles today. Commitment, faithfulness. Psalm chapter 57, verse number 7, the Bible says this. It's a great, great verse of Scripture here. Psalms 57:7. My heart is fixed, O God. My heart is fixed. I will sing and give praise. In spite of his problems, David was stable and steadfast in his life, and his heart was fixed. How do you get a fixed or steadfast heart? How do you become steadfast? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:58, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for you know that your work in the Lord is not in vain. And all on the Bible says, it's at the end of the resurrection chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, it's a great chapter. But it tells us to be committed. It tells us to be stable. It tells us to nail ourselves down, in a sense, and stay in a place where God wants you and just stay there no matter what happens. Stay there. Find yourself a good church. Get in that church and stay. Stay. And stay. Stay. And stay. And stay. I don't care what happens. Stay. 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 God wants you to stay. Stay. Be steadfast. Unmovable. Yeah, but somebody hurt my feelings. Man, my feelings have been hurt so many. I don't even know sometimes I got any feelings left, you know. How about you? Yeah, we've all been there. Come on. Be steadfast. Be unmovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. Be committed to being reliable or faithful. How do you get fixed or steadfast? That will enable you to face any circumstance that comes your way. How does a Christian stay dedicated to Christ and keep a song in his heart and praise pouring from his lips like David? How does a discouraged Christian keep from quitting in his service to the Lord? The Bible provides a number of important insights to this question. So let's see some of them. Let's go to the book of Daniel. We're very familiar with this, but Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. How does a Christian become steadfast? There must be a willingness. Now, you need to get this tonight. If, like I used to say, I haven't said this for a long time, but if you miss everything else, get this tonight. This is important. I used to say a lot of times, my wife said, you need to quit saying that. I said, well, and I think I forgot about it and I quit saying it. So, but whatever the case may be, this is a good thing. If you don't get anything else, get this. There must be a willingness to stand alone. As a pastor, you have to be willing to stand alone. As a Christian, you have to be willing to stand alone. Daniel chapter 3, Daniel was willing, or these three Hebrew children was willing to stand alone, as well as Daniel in Daniel chapter 6. But the three Hebrew children in Daniel chapter 3, first of all, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, verse 16, answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. And let me interpret that. Very respectful to his office. He was an unsaved king, but they were respectful to his position, and they said, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, Be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Everybody else bowed down, except three. And you read that, and it's almost like, well, maybe they didn't hear the music. Let's give them a second chance. So they played the music again. You know, what the music everyone's supposed to bow, and they're still standing there. You imagine that in a nation of all those people, in a foreign nation, in a pagan land, and everybody bows down to the golden image, and there's three of them standing up. Do you think they were noticed? Yeah. I remember when I went to high school and went to Southport and graduated from another school, but remember I used to carry my Bible to school. I carry my Bible to school. Back in those days, you had all the books. Now you got probably a computer, laptop, whatever. It makes it a lot easier. But we had books. So you got to go to the locker and get your books. And your locker was always the other end of the school. And one class was clearing. You got 5 minutes. You got to run down. And then no running in the halls. And you got all kinds of stuff. But you got all these books. But I had a Bible. And I had a Schofield Bible. And I think Renee maybe got that for me. Bought me a Bible, my favorite color is green. So I had a green Schofield Bible. It has green Schofield Bible on top of my history books and all that. And I didn't read it in class, but in study hall. When I was done with my studying, I'd pull out my Bible. And you know what? People noticed in the 70s that you had a Bible. And it wasn't like patting on the back, you know? No, no, no. Hey, he's got a Bible. Hey, look at this guy. He's a Bible freak. And then everybody's looking at you. I didn't care. I was glad as a Christian. I don't know if kids do that today or if you even care, but I don't even know today. But even in that day, not many kids took their Bibles to school and carried it. You know why? Didn't want to stand alone. Didn't want to be ridiculed. No, I'm not anything special. There's other kids, I'm sure, at that day did the same thing. But you have to be willing to stand alone. You have to be willing. If you're going to have a fixed heart, you must be willing to stand alone all by yourself. Daniel chapter 6. This is the passage for Daniel. Daniel chapter 6, verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open, his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God. And don't miss this, as he did aforetime. He done it every day. It's common practice. He opens the windows, he's praying. Everybody probably in the community knew, there's Daniel, he's praying again. Didn't bother him until it really got under the skin of some of the people. And they really kind of said, the only way we're going to get to Daniel is to get to him through his God somehow, because he had like an impeccable testimony. He purposed in his heart. It's an outstanding, what we would call a Christian believer today. But he was willing to stand alone. He's thrown into the lion's den. But it's interesting when you read all that the king was beside himself, because he liked Daniel. And he got almost, I kind of think he almost got tricked into signing something. He didn't really realize it, but he couldn't change it because the Medes and the Persians, and when he put his ring to that document, he couldn't change it. But the Bible says he was going like up maybe through the night, kind of, he couldn't go to sleep, wondering how Daniel was doing down there in the lion's den. And the next day we know the story, went down there and Daniel's, I don't know if he's patting the lion, I don't know, but he's okay. People say they weren't hungry. Well, tell that to the next bunch that they threw down there. Yeah, right. And the Bible says they broke their bones before they ever hit the ground. No, they were hungry. But God sent an angel or angels and shut them out the line. But he must be first willing to stand alone. A lot of people aren't willing to stand alone. But in your commitment, if you're going to be committed and you're going to have a fixed heart, we're talking about the heart on Sunday and Sunday night during this month, you must be committed to being reliable. And you must be committed to being faithful. And you must be willing to stand alone. And when you stand alone, God will help you to have a fixed heart. And the three Hebrew children said, we know God's able to save us, but if he doesn't, we're still not bowing down. They kind of purposed in their heart, you see. They were committed to a course of action, and it wasn't going to change. Have convictions in your life and know what you're going to do before you're ever in the situation. I've said for years from this pulpit, make sure that you've learned in the light so that when it comes to the darkness, you don't do something in the darkness. That's wrong because you committed in the light. Know what you're going to do before you get to a situation, if you can, and prepare for that. Second thing here, recognition of the Lord's presence and care in spite of difficult circumstances will develop a fixed heart. Take your Bible and go to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. The Bible says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Then what's it say, church? Because he trusteth in thee. If you're going to have a fixed heart, you've got to trust and be committed to being faithful and be committed to being reliable. And I've said before, the greatest peace that I have, turn to Philippians chapter 1. The greatest peace that I have in my life is when I get up off my knees. There's a lot of things swirling around in the culture. You know that? And you know what? I can't control hardly any of those. But I can pray. Now, we ought to be aware, but I'm not going to go crazy. I'm going to pray, and I can control my prayer life. And I can control my time I call out to God in behalf of whatever. And when I get up off my knees and I get done with my prayer list, and I pray for a lot of things, and you pray a prayer list too, there's a peace that I have in my life that I don't have any other time. Because I'm casting all my burdens upon him, for he careth for you. And he's got bigger shoulders. I go down on my knees worried, fearful. But I come up off of my knees with the peace that he talks about in Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3 that we just read. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace. Now, I don't know about you, but I would imagine the same peace he gives to me, he probably would give to you. I don't have a corner on the market, but all I can say is, for me, when I get up off my knees and I put all my prayer requests to the Lord, and I'm praying for people, certain people to be saved, and people to be in church, and offerings, and different things, and all the things that God lays in my mind, I make a list, and I write those things, and I pray day after day after day after day, and I pray those and add those things, and I check things off that God answers. When I get up from praying, I have a peace that I don't have any other time in my life. And it says, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Try the praying and see. And if you're worried and fearful and fretful right now, then maybe you ought to be praying a little bit more. Or maybe you ought to start praying. And I'm not minimizing. We're living in difficult times and fearful times. But we don't have to be afraid. We have a God that helps us. And God's not given us the spirit of fear, but of a sound mind. Now, we need to be cautious. We need to be wise. We're talking about just doing correct. But it's amazing. In my life, the peace that I get from praying and the peace I lose when I stop praying. That's my life. But I'm telling you, if it works for me, I just kind of think it would work for anybody. Because he talks about that. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 20. According to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. The word expectation means this. It means an intense look which turns away from everything else to fix or focus on one object or one desire. You might call that tunnel vision. You might call that putting blinders on the horse. Why? So the horse don't look this way. And when he looks that way, he can only see just this far. He can't look off over here because of those blinders. We need to focus our attention on what God has for us and be committed to trusting Him and not worry about what's going on over here and what's going over there and what about out there. And because it gets depressing and it gets discouraging and you can't even control it anyway, but you're all over the place. It's an intense look which turns away from everything else. I think the scripture says it this way: looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Author is salvation, finisher that completes it, glorified by all that. He's the author and the finisher. But so many times in our life we start looking at everything else. And we take our eyes off of Him. And we get messed up. We all thrill to Nathan Hale's patriotic declaration, where he said, "I only regret that I have only but one life to give to my country or for my country." Yet all too often we make some slight infirmity of the body our excuse for not serving the Lord. We contemplate with all the inspiring poems of Martha Snell. She was a woman who suffered from 4 incurable diseases and struggled with pain for more than 35 years. Anybody in that boat tonight? I'm not, thank God. But this illustrates trust. Trust. Sometimes, I don't really feel like going tonight, so we don't go. 35 years of constant pain, an invalid bound to her bed. Thank God I'm not bound to my bed. Yet her spirit was so transcendently triumphed through those weary years that she wrote some of the finest Christian poetry which has ever been written. One of them was called Treasures. One by one he took them from me, all the things I valued most. And God can do that in any of our lives. Until I was empty-handed, even glittering toy was lost. And I walked earth's highways grieving in my rags and poverty till I heard His voice inviting, "Lift your empty hands to me." So I held my hands toward heaven, and He filled them with a store of His own transcendent riches till they could contain no more. He will open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you cannot receive. And at last I comprehended with my stupid mind and dull that God could not pour His riches into hands already full. How many of us in our lives, we fill in our lives with everything else except Him? And we wonder why we're getting it. Because our hands are already too full with everything else. A third commitment here tonight. Be committed to being repentant over your sin. Don't ever lose sight that if you get away from God and you sin, that you need to repent and confess your sin and ask God to forgive you. Nothing keeps the church running like the spirit of forgiveness and the oil that keeps it all working together. Turn to Psalms 32 tonight. Psalms 32 tonight. Boy, isn't this an exciting book that we have called the Bible? has so much in it that can really help us in a practical way. Psalms 32:5. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin, Selah. And the word Selah means to pause and think about what's just been said. Turn to Psalms chapter 38, verse 18. 38, verse 18. For I will declare mine iniquity. I will be sorry for my sin. You know, there's a verse of Scripture in the Old Testament. I don't know it off the top of my head here tonight. But it talks about where the people had lost their blush. You know what that means? It means nothing really offended them or caused them to blush, no matter what they heard. And I'm afraid that today, so many times, even the Christian life, we've heard so much junk, we've seen so much stuff, we've heard so much profanity, and nothing causes us to blush. Remember one time going into school and visiting some young people sitting at the lunch table, and girls, young girls, talking about things that made me blush. But we live in a world that there's not much blush at all. And sin is eating us alive and destroying our lives, tearing us apart, tearing our nation apart. Married for 16 years with two great kids, Kurt Stansell seemed to have had it all together. He had a successful investment counseling business. He was the founding elder at his church. He was also a sex addict. So it's in the churches too. Let's not think it's not, because it is. Kurt was the first to admit his problem. For years, Kurt struggled with pornography. Started with magazines, but eventually turned into visits to Triple X theaters and strip joints. Kurt kept repeating a cycle of guilt and remorse, then prayer and repentance, only to find himself back in it again. That was the time when you walked into a place and you were afraid people might see you. And I've talked about today, we have it on our phones. We can be watching it while our family's watching something else, a nice wholesome thing on TV, and we're sitting there in another chair watching pornography. It's all around us. It's eating us up. It's billions of dollars of industry. It's destroying people. It's all over the place. It's in churches. It's in Christian colleges. It's everywhere. Eventually, Kurt found an accountability partner named Stan. At first, Kurt held back, but being less than honest about his problem. But when he finally confessed, telling Stan the whole truth, Kurt immediately felt a weight lifted from his shoulders. He was on the road to victory. Kurt said, I began to understand what shame does. When we as Christians try to hide something in the darkness, we give Satan incredible power and license to work in our lives. So the more open I could be, the less of a hold Satan seemed to have in my life. Some men refuse to confess their sin to the Lord today because they do not acknowledge the authority of Jesus Christ as God. But an autonomous author made this striking comparison. Socrates, now listen to this, this is powerful. Socrates taught for 40 years, Plato for 50 years, Aristotle for 40 years, and Jesus for 3 years. Yet the influence of Christ's 3-year ministry infinitely transcends the impact left by the combined 130 years of teaching from these men, who were among the greatest philosophers of all time. Jesus painted no pictures, yet some of the finest paintings of Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci received the inspiration from the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus wrote no poetry, but Dante and Milton and scores of the world's greatest poets were inspired by our Savior. Jesus composed no music, yet Handel and Haydn and Beethoven and Bach and Mendelssohn reached their highest perfection of melody in the hymns that they wrote, in symphonies and oratories they composed in their praise of the Son of God. Every sphere of human greatness has been enriched by this humble carpenter of Nazareth. His unique contribution to the race of men is the salvation of the soul. That's what changes people. Philosophy could not accomplish that. Neither could art, literature, or music save a sinner's soul. Only Jesus Christ can break the enslaving chains of sin and Satan. He alone can speak peace to the human heart, strengthen the weak, and give life to those who are spiritually dead. I've given you three commitments tonight that will change your life if you'll let them. But you must be committed to trusting the Lord. You must be committed to being reliable or faithful to the Lord. And you must be committed to being repentant over your sin. And all God's people said. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. We're grateful tonight to have with us here a guest tonight, Dennis and Diana Hazelwood. They're missionaries and out to like Fort Leonard Wood out in Missouri, and missionary or military. Couldn't think of the word military. And I was at Fort Leonard Wood when I was in Bible college. We went out there and we witnessed to those people and brought them in by busloads to church. And so he has that type of a ministry. They're visiting our church tonight. So I want to ask him if he would dismiss us in prayer tonight. Thank you so much for being here tonight. We hope the service has been a help and encouragement to you. God bless you.